إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وكل محدثة بدعة. And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وكل بدعة ضلالة. Every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وكل ضلالة في النار. Every going astray and every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, there are certain times of the year, of our year, that are a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where acts of obedience to Allah are very beneficial and advantageous. These times are gifts, blessings, favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to generously reward His servants for small actions. So opportunities lie ahead of us as we approach these first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah. The moon was not sighted this evening in Saudi Arabia, so they have completed 30 days tomorrow, and the first of Dhul Hijjah, the first day, will be this Sunday, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But these are no ordinary days. And it is so sad to see some squander and lose these days, not giving them the priority and the reverence that they deserve. These are not normal days. And those who are not in Hajj should not treat them as normal days. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن أحب إلى الله من هذه الأيام العشر. قالوا يا رسول الله ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله؟ قال ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله إلا رجل خرج بنفسه وماله ولم يرجع من ذلك بشيء. This hadith which we have in the Sunan of al-Tirmidhi and in the Sahih, it's authentic. And Imam al-Bukhari has a similar wording to it. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, there are no days during which righteous deeds are more beloved to Allah that you do them in that time than these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. The companion said, O Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, not even jihad in the way of Allah, not even fighting to defend our deen or to defend one who's being pushed out of their home, not even the one who is engaged in jihad. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, not even the one who engages in jihad except for a person who was to go out with himself and his wealth and he comes back with neither, meaning he dies on the battlefield and he loses all his wealth at the same time. Ibn Rajab, rahimahullah, he said this hadith is a proof that performing good deeds during these 10 days are more beloved to Allah than performing any good deeds at any other time of the year, any other days of the year on earth, without any exception. So what are the virtues of these 10 days? Allah, first of all, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He swears by them. And when Allah swears by something, it is a magnificent thing. It is a huge thing. It is not a minor detail. When Allah swears by a thing, like when He swears by time, wal asr, time is something that's invaluable. You can't get it back once it passes. Allah as well, He swears by these 10 days when He says, wal fajr, wa layalin ashr. When Allah swears by the dawn and by these 10 nights, according to Ibn Abbas, and Mujahid and Zubair and others, the majority of the Salaf, they said, these 10 nights, they're referring to the 10 days of the Hijjah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in these 10 days of the Hijjah, on the day of Arafah, He completed this deen, which is a favor to all of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He completed the religion of Islam on the day of Arafah, which is the ninth of the Hijjah, when it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenukum, wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati, wa raditu lakum al-islami deena. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said what means, this day I have perfected for you your religion, and completed my favor upon you, and chosen for you al-Islam as your religion. So Allah, He, in these ayat, يعني, He venerates these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah because the deen was completed, the favor was completed, the mission was sealed with these ayat on the day of Arafah. And Allah, He swears by the day of Arafah, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ, by the heavens holding up the big stars, وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ, and the promised day, the day of resurrection, because it's a promise that it will come, that everything will perish, and Allah will bring us all back to life to question us and weigh our good deeds and our bad deeds. وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ وَشَاهِدٍ, and by the witnessing day, this day of Jum'ah, every day is a witness to the believer, on the believers. وَالْمَشْهُودِ, the day of Arafah, it is the witness day, where Allah and the angels, they witness the servants leaving their comfortability, leaving their homelands, leaving everything to go to beg Allah for forgiveness on this day of Arafah. The first 10 days of the Hijjah, they are part of the 40 nights, the 40 days that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He spent with Musa alayhi salam on Turi Sina at the top of Mount Sinai. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَوَاعَدْنَا مُوسَى 30 لَيْلَةً وَأَتْمَمْنَاهَا بِعَشْرٍ فَتَمَّ مِيقَاتُ رَبِّهِ 40 لَيْلَةً. Allah says what means, and we made an appointment with Moses, with Musa alayhi salam, for 30 days. Those 30 days, according to the Mufassirin, means the 30 days of Dhul Qi'dah, this month that we've been in. One of the sacred months of the four. And what? Many of us squandered these days, not realizing the specialness and the holiness of this time. So those 30 days of Dhul Qi'dah, Allah, He spent them with Musa, and then He had the addition of 10. Those additional 10 days are said to be the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. So the term of His Lord was completed as 40 nights. In this we remind ourselves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has speech. Because there are some who deny this attribute because they say it is likening Allah to His creation, and this is foolishness. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is no one and nothing comparable to Allah, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, and He is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. Allah said, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah said in the Quran that Allah, He spoke to Musa alayhi salam directly without Musa seeing Him alayhi salam, but He spoke. So it is affirmed that Allah can speak to His servants as He did to Musa alayhi salam, as He did with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam on Mi'raj, without anyone seeing Him. The first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, they fall at the end of the well-known months of Hajj. From when Ramadan is done, Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, these are known as the month of Hajj. Why? Because the person can go and make Umrah, return to their home, and go back for Hajj, and they have that Hajj Tamattu, or that greatest Hajj that they can complete. These first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are days legislated by Allah for us to thank Him for all that He has blessed us with, including the livestock and the animals He has given for us to eat from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَىٰ كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ وَيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ عَلَىٰ مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hajj, He says, and what means, and proclaim to the people the Hajj, the pilgrimage. They will come to you on every foot, on foot, and on every lean camel, and they will come from every distant pathway and area, that they may witness and attend to the benefit for themselves, the benefits in this dunya and the benefits of the rewards of the akhirah, and that they may mention Allah on known specific days over what He has provided for them from the sacrificial animals. According to the Jamhur of the ulama, These 10 days, al-ayyam al-ma'lumat, these are the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. As Ibn Kathir stated, that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, this refers to the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. Shaykh al-Sa'di rahimahullah, he said that these appointed days are actually at the time of slaughter, that you mention Allah's name at the time of slaughter. So he considered it the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah after the Eid prayer and the 3 days of Tashriq. The point of the matter, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these 10 days brings us much virtue and great reward. Righteous deeds are more beloved, as we said, at this time than at any other time of the year. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, afdalu ayyam al-dunya, ayyam al-ashar. The best days of your dunya, of your year, are these first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. How many people do we see exert in Ramadan to read the Quran, to do dhikr, to give in charity, to fast, and to do the likes of these matters? Yet these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, because we're not on Hajj, you treat them like any other day. And this is a crime. A crime I advise myself, we do against our own souls. The pilgrimage to Mecca, we know, is done at these times. Last year, instead of 3 and 4 million people doing it, the numbers were restricted from COVID. It's a sight that is so sad to the heart to see, that those who could go and leave their families, leave their wealth, leave their comfort to go to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make tawaf, to make sa'i between Safa and Marwa, to go to Arafah and beg for forgiveness, to sit in the tents of Mina remembering Allah, that this is restricted, but this is what Allah has decreed. This is what Allah has decreed. Even this year, maybe they're allowing some 60,000 from the local residents to just make the Hajj. Such a drastic decrease in the numbers. But these are the days of Hajj, and we hope that Allah allows us to get to the position where we can all go and make the pilgrimage to His house. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من حج لله فلم يرفث ولم يفسق رجع كيوم ولدته أمه. In the authentic hadith, we see the value of the Hajj that's done in these days, where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, whoever makes Hajj for the sake of Allah's face and does not have any intimacy with their spouse and does not do evil or sin, they will return from Hajj like the day born to their mother, free of sin. The sins that we accumulate in masses every day, Allah will wipe them clean for the one who goes and makes the Hajj Mabrur. The Hajj Mabrur, the accepted Hajj. In these days, people go to Allah's service. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. O Allah, I'm at your service, O Allah. Dedicating everything they have in them to go and worship their Creator and seek the Hajj Mabrur. Commemorating our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, his call to Tawheed, to the worshipping of only Allah alone without any partners, and leaving off every other type of worship towards anything other than, or anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Commemorating his sacrifice, where he was going to lay his son down on the table and sacrifice him, his obedience. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, or afwan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لا شريك له وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what means. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed, my prayer, my sacrifice, my life and my death are for you alone, without any partner, the Lord of the worlds. No partner do you have in when I worship you. You have no partners that we should associate with you. And I am the first who come to you as from the Muslimin, from those who submit to you. In these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, we have the day of Arafah, one of the best blessed days of the year, a great day where Allah frees more of His slaves from the hellfire than at any other day of the year. عن ابن مسيد قال قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما من يوم أكثر من أن يعتق الله فيه عبدا من النار من يوم عرفة وإنه ليدنو ثم يباهي بهم الملائكة فيقول ما أراد هؤلاء ما أراد هؤلاء رواه مسلم. The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the authentic hadith, there is no day during which Allah frees more worshippers from the hellfire than on the day of Arafah. Verily on that day, Allah draws near to His servants. He descends from His arsh to the lowest heavens in a manner which suits His majesty. We do not ask how, because we are incapable of understanding that how. All right, he draws near and he expresses his pride to the angels about those who made the Hajj seeking his pleasure and forgiveness, saying, what do they want? Just because we're not on Hajj doesn't mean we lose out. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صوم يوم عرفة يكفر سنتين ماضية ومستقبلة. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the Sahih Hadith, in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, he said, the fasting of the day of Arafah for those not on Hajj, which is going to coincide with Monday, July 19th. That day of Arafah, whoever fasts it, they get their previous year of sins and the upcoming year of sins forgiven. This is for the minor sins that you don't do intentionally. Someone can't say, well, my sins are forgiven for the upcoming year, so let me go and do such and such. This is for the unintentional sins. On these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, we get to the 10th day, Yawm al-Nahr, the day of sacrifice. And it is the 10th and the best day, the greatest day of Hajj, because of all the rites that are done on it. Sacrificing the sacrificial animal, making tawaf, shaving the head for the men, cutting the hair for the women, stoning the jamrat al-Aqaba. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ أَعْظَمَ الْأَيَّامِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى يَوْمَ النَّحْرِ ثُمَّ يَوْمَ الْقَرْ. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith which is Hassan, in the Sunan of Abi Dawud, in the Muslim of Imam Ahmad, he said that the best day in the sight of Allah, blessed and exalted is He, is يَوْمَ النَّحْرِ, the 10th day of the Hijjah, the day of sacrifice. Then يَوْمَ الْقَرْ, the day after that, the 11th of Dhul-Hijjah, where the pilgrims begin their stay in Mecca. So what do we do during these virtuous times? Make tawbah and nasuha, sincere repentance to Allah. Ask Allah for forgiveness. Make takbir throughout all the times of these hours and these days. Remember Allah so you get closer to Him. Thank Him for allowing us to see another 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah if we live to see them, where we could praise Him and glorify Him and give charity in His cause and fast and do the likes of these and be generous and exert yourself in your kindness. Do not be Ramadan Muslims. These 10 days are the best 10 days of the year. The best 10 days of our year. Do not squander them or lose them out. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أفضل أيام الدنيا أيام العشر, the best 10 days of your dunya, the days. According to the علماء, the best 10 nights are the last 10 nights of Ramadan, because إنما ليلة القدر وليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر. Right? It is Laylatul Qadr. It's better than 1,000 months. But the best 10 days of your year are these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. Do not lose them out. So what are some preferable deeds to do during these 10 days? Ones that are preferable above all other types of deeds. It is to increase in the remembrance of Allah. As we said, وَيَذْكُرُ اسْمُ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ, that they mention the name of Allah on specific appointed days according to the majority of the Salaf of the Sahaba. This means to say takbir at all times during these first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. Increase in saying, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Alhamdulillah. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Man ahalla muhillun qat, illa bushira, wa la kabbara mukabbirin qat, illa bushira, qila ya Rasulullah, bil jannah, qala na'am. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, a person doesn't make talbiyah, لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك, for those who are in Hajj during these times, except that he's given glad tidings. And a person who's not in Hajj doesn't make takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, during these first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, except that he's given glad tidings. The companion said, of Jannah? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, na'am. He said, yes. And he affirmed this. These are not times to listen to the radio, to watch TV, to lose these times of idleness where you're not just remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Khattabi, he said the wisdom behind saying takbir in these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah is that in Jahiliyyah, the mushrikeen, they used to sacrifice to the multiple gods, wal-a'yadu billah, during these 10 days. So saying takbir on these 10 days was legislated as an indication for those specifically slaughtering for Allah upon His name. عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما من أيام أعظم عند الله ولا أحب إليه من العمل فيهن من هذه الأيام العشر فأكثر من التهليل والتكبير والتحميد. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said there are no days that are better in the sight of Allah and during which deeds are more beloved to Allah than in these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, these first 10 days. So during them, frequently say, he said, أكثر من التهليل والتكبير والتحميد. Say a lot. تهليل, لا إله إلا الله. تكبير, الله أكبر. تحميد, الحمد لله. So do not lose out on these times. قال البخاري, كان ابن عمر وأبو هريرة كانوا يخرجان بالسوق حتى كان يخرجاني بالسوق في أيام العشر ويكبران ويكبر الناس بتكبيرهما. البخاري, he mentions that Abu Huraira and Ibn Umar, they used to go out to the marketplaces during these first 10 days of the Hijjah and they would make takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, and the likes of what is authenticated from the Sahaba. They would make it out loud in the marketplaces. Even in the masajid, you come in during these times, the people are silent. You're losing out on great reward, great help, great hasanat to weigh your scales on the day of resurrection. They would do this out loud in the marketplaces, and the people would hear them making takbir. So this is, we know the sunnah is that you say it out loud. You don't say it to yourself. And the people would say takbir after them, because they would hear it, they would remind them of that and the likes of this. وعن نافع إن عن ابن عمر أنه كان يكبر في جميع أيام العشر على فراشه ومجلسه. النافع, he reported that ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما, he used to make takbir at all times during these 10 days of the Hajjah, even when he was sitting down or laying on his bed, on his mattress. So these days are days for us to increase in just worshipping Allah, saying tahleel, la ilaha illallah, takbir, Allahu Akbar, tahmeed, alhamdulillah, and the likes of these matters because of the reward. Fasting during these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, of course, Allah said, as-siyam innahu li, the fasting is for me, wa ana ajzi bih, and I'll reward for it. So although there is, يعني Shaykh al-Albani, hassan al-hadith, he made hassan the hadith that says that he used to fast these first 9 days of the Hijjah, according to what his wife's, Hunayda ibn Khalid narrated, according to his wife, that some of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ told me that the Prophet ﷺ used to fast the day of Ashura, the first 9 of the Hijjah, and the 3 days out of every month. This one, although Shaykh al-Albani hassanahu, he made it hassan, some of the ulama had a difference whether it was authentic or not. But we know that fasting is from the good deeds you can do. So if you want to, you can fast from those first 9 days. You cannot fast the 10th, that is, as it is the day of Eid. Standing the night in prayer and tahajjud, of course, Ibn Rajab, Imam al-Shafi'i, the likes, they said that it's definitely preferable to do so. Again, this is done in Ramadan regularly. It's sought out. You plan your day, but in these 10 days of the Hijjah, these beneficial actions seem to be out of our minds, and we are the ones who will lose. A quick mention about the udhiyah, or the sacrifice at this time, for those preparing to sacrifice. Of course, it has merits. Allah said, إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ. O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, indeed we have given you al-kawthar, the fountain, the abundance. فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. So turn to your Lord in prayer and sacrifice. This sacrifice, التعبد إلى الله بعراقة الدم, this is worship to Allah by letting the blood flow from the animal that is sacrificed. To praise Him and to thank Him, to submit to Allah, to show gratitude to Allah for the blessings and the favors He's given you, to revive the great practice started by our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, and to feed others during the feed days. It is an obligation on every household to do so. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من وجد سعة لأن يضحي فلم يضحي فلم يقربن مصلانا. This hadith, which is Hassan by Shaykh al-Albani in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever has the capacity to offer an udhiya, a sacrifice, and doesn't do so, should not approach our musalla, should not come near our place of prayer. So this is an obligation. Of course, if you cannot do so financially whatsoever, then the obligation, inshallah, is lifted from you. But there's regulations. This should be done sincerely for the face of Allah, not to brag about. This should be done with halal earnings, halal provisions, halal money that you have, not with something haram. And for the one who's intending the sacrifice, usually let's say it's the head of the household, the husband or the father or whatever. If he's the one intending the sacrifice on behalf of his household, then he is the one only in that house that has to refrain from clipping his hair or nails, shaving or removing any hair, or even peeling off any skin. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر وعنده أضحية يريد أن يضحي بها فلا يأخذن شعرا ولا يقلمن ظفرا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in an authentic hadith, when the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah start, so the one intending the sacrifice from Saturday night, from tomorrow night, from Maghrib, no more removing nails, cutting nails of the fingers or the toes, no more trimming any hair. The beard should be left to grow anyway. No more trimming the mustache or touching the hair on top of your head. You want to do it, you have until tomorrow at Maghrib to do what is permissible for you to do. And then you shouldn't refrain from any of this. We remind ourselves of the fitrah. The five acts of fitrah is the circumcision, removing the hair under the arms, removing the hair in the pubic region for the male and the female, cutting the fingernails of the hands and the toes. Right? These are from the aspects of the fitrah, of the natural disposition of cleanliness and purity we were blessed with Islam. So if you have to do these things, you can't go more than 40 days for the men and the women, not removing the hair under their arms or in their pubic region or cutting their nails of their hands or their fingers, right? So if you're getting close to that, do it before sunset, if you're the one intending the sacrifice. If it's the male, let's say it's the father, the wife, the children, do not have to follow those restrictions. But if the wife said, well, I want to get closer to Allah and please Allah, I want to do a sacrifice as well, then she intends it, even if her husband pays it, then if it's in her intention, she should also refrain from cutting the nails, hair, or any skin. Say you get a hangnail, it's bothering you, your finger's throbbing, this is allowed for you to remove, and your udhiyah is still acceptable, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. This must be done after Salat al-Eid. If it is a sheep, it must be 6 months old at a minimum, preferably a year. The goat, at least 1 year old. The cow, at least 2 years old. And they must be free of any defects. They don't have a limp, they're not sick, they don't have a slit in their ear, and the likes of these matters. This is all from the perfection that we turn to Allah with, seeking to worship Him, to gain closeness to Him, and to be obedient to Him. Again, the sunnah, without a doubt, is for you to do the udhiyah yourself with your own hand. For you to go to a place and you slaughter the animal yourself. Second best, if you're afraid to do so, or you're afraid you might not do it right, you go and you watch it being done, so you can also make sure the name of Allah is mentioned over it. You and your family, it's on behalf of you and your family. And you can get from the meat for you to eat from it and disperse some of it. According to some of the ulama, such as Sheikh Ibn Jibreen, rahimahullah, and the likes, if you really can't do so, or if you want to do something extra on top of that, you can send it out to other countries. But without a doubt, the best thing for you is to try and do both, so that you maintain the sunnah by doing the udhiyah yourself, and you send something abroad. Right now, we have set up something, we did it last year, I believe about 20 sheep or so in Lebanon, because we have entrusted people over there who can do so. The formula for the baby that used to be $10 is now $33. $10 to $33. They're struggling. The people called back out here asking, can you do it again? Can you do it again? The udhiyah there for one sheep is $300. We would need your name on an envelope so that they can pronounce it when they slaughter it, and the $300 in cash, and it has to be by next Friday so that we can set up and arrange it so it's done at the proper time, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Again, Eid, inshallah, will be Tuesday, June 20th. We'll announce the location next week. The day of Arafah, a day for all of us to fast and earn forgiveness for the previous and upcoming year of sins, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, is Monday, July 19th. Did I say June? July 19th is Arafah. July 20th will be the day of Eid. And the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah will be, day-wise, Sunday, this Sunday, July 11th, at Maghrib time. You refrain, if you're intending the sacrifice, you refrain from clipping your hair, nails, cutting any hair, shaving any hair, and the likes of these matters. May Allah make us of those who benefit from this knowledge and worship Him and glorify Him and praise Him during these first 10 days of the Hijjah. Allahumma khalil al-Muslimin wal-Muslimat wal-Mu'minin wal-Mu'minat wal-Ahya' minhum wal-Amwat innaka anta sami' al-Qayyim al-Mujib al-Da'wat ya muqallib al-Qulub thabit qulubina ala dinik subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.